at 5:40 a.m.
Welcome to the No Sour Ha Ha Fun Time Power Hour.
You need some whoop whoop boing.
Absolutely.
Moving Wisconsin forward, one joke at a time. This is Kristen Bry with As Goes Wisconsin.
Yada, yada, yada.
Hello, Wisconsin! Hello, Wisconsin! Welcome to the No Sour Ha Ha Fun Time Power Hour. And boy, are we going to have some fun in this hour. Our guest, who I'm so excited to have on, is an actor and producer who's been in the entertainment business for over 30 years. You know him from West Wing, Get Out, Handmaid's Tale, countless other movies and TV shows, but he is also a Wisconsin native, and he's been very vocal about Wisconsin politics for at least a decade, if not more. Welcome to the show, three-time Emmy Award winner, Bradley Whitford.
It's under his eye. It's really great to
under
be here.
His eye. Oh, man. How many showers do you have to take after playing Commander Joseph Lawrence?
it's a little tricky. I'll sometimes when people on the street come up, they'll say very nice things, and I'll say, well, I hope you're an obedient woman. And my wife will slap me.
As she should. As she should.
Restoring balance to the universe.
Yes, yes.
So I have to tell you this story,
yes,
because
please.
So I, 20 years ago, which is humbling to think of, I was 16. It was 2003. You had obviously already been in the West Wing. And I had the opportunity to move from Madison, Wisconsin to LA to pursue acting. And
it's a mistake,
in the,
but go ahead.
Yes. Well, I'm back here now. And my dad was with me. And my dad was a big businessman, big networker. Really saw the power of networking. And he knew you were from Wisconsin. So he was convinced that if we just somehow got connected to you, the Wisconsin connection, and then somehow you'd help me out. And that didn't work out so much. But now, 20 years later, here you are on my show.
Oh, my God. Did I ever talk to your father?
No. God, oh. No. He just, his he had no, my dad was in finance. And so the entertainment thing was brand new to him. And yet his mind went to networking. He's like, who do we know?
Right.
What Wisconsin connections do we have in Hollywood? And so he thought of all the Wisconsin actors he could think of.
Well, I'll tell you, I it's funny because I've always been, you know, there is no more rewarding activity than acting. I've always felt like it's the only sort of integrated, it's part of why I fell in love with it, because it uses my head, it uses my heart, it uses my body. I didn't have to turn anything off in order to do it. The activity, there is nothing better, but the business is, even if you're lucky, mm-hmm. trust me, and I know how lucky I am, it's a very tough thing to navigate. So when I talk to young people now, I'm a lot more circumspect about it, because
are you?
Yeah, because it's brutal. Like I went to acting school after I went to college. I went to 4 years at Juilliard. Three of us make a living.
Wow. Of your class?
Yeah.
Wow.
Acting. Yeah. Yeah. It's brutal.
It is brutal.
It's tough. And you never, here I am, lucky actor, looking at Miami's complaint.
No, but it's so, and I think that was the thing, even at a young age, when I, not to make this about me, but when I decided, I was like, I should go to college.
Absolutely.
It's so out of your hands, the acting thing. It's
yes.
like, no matter how talented you are, no matter how hard you work, you are at the mercy of other people wanting to cast you. And then that project, after you're even cast, that project doing well so that you have a name for yourself.
And you have no control. And trust me, when you're shooting, there's a lot of movies that you don't remember that I was in that I thought, wow, this is going to be amazing. When I'm shooting Get Out, I have no idea. No idea.
Yeah.
You have no idea. No idea. And what's hard about being an actor is whatever that is, whatever that assertive part of your personality that has you on the radio, that has you going to a movie theater, had you like going to a Broadway play and going, I want to be up there. It's a very assertive part of your nature. A very small percentage of the population doesn't think that's a nightmare. So there's this assertive part of you, and then the business renders you totally passive.
Yeah. And yet here you are, just a little Wisconsin boy who's made it. And so what was that journey as far as we're talking to Bradley Whitford, actor, producer, Wisconsin native. So you went to Madison East?
I went to East.
You went to East. I went to West. But, okay. You know, that's okay.
Yeah. You guys were the snobby guys.
Well, we were the high school that was closest to the university. So yeah. We had a bunch of university, like college professor kids. But as far as, so you talk about the business, you went to Juilliard. What was the break? The break wasn't Billy Madison, was it?
No. The
business ethics.
There's a series. I mean, I'm lucky because I've had a sort of boiled frog level of luck in show business rather than sort of one event. A big piece of luck. My first play was Curse of the Starving Class with Kathy Bates, which was a huge break. Very, very scary break because you have to be stark naked on stage. in New York was a little terrifying. And I had to squat down because that's what you want to do when you're naked is squat.
Totally.
And pick up a live lamb who I named Meryl Sheep. But then I got a break when Aaron Sorkin, this young playwright, allowed me to not only cast me in a supporting part in A Few Good Men, but then allowed me to go into the lead, which was very weird. So I was the lead in a Broadway play. My dressing room was bigger than my apartments, and they had 24-hour security guard there. So my dog and I moved into the dressing room at the music box. Nice. But the big break was West Wing. That sort of changed everything.
And so I guess then that kind of transfers into, were you, because I think one of the things we see now, especially for those of us who live in Wisconsin, who are political, who lean left, you have been vocal about Wisconsin politics for a long time. And did that, how, pre-West Wing.
Where did that come from?
Yeah, I mean, like pre-West Wing.
My family, I was raised Quaker, and the whole idea that was sort of pounded into us was, of course, nonviolence, but was you had to put your values into action. And it actually opens up a sort of interesting thing. I think one of the reasons that we have a form of minority tyranny in this country is that the right understands what I believe to be the truth. And I think we can actually learn from them. They understand that politics is the way you create your moral vision. On the left, we tend to think it's the stuff that I do. We think that culture is the way you create your moral vision. But will and grace won't help you if you have a pre-existing condition. And Handmaid's Tale has now been a big hit for 6 years. And it doesn't seem to be helping on the abortion front. You have to follow through politically. And that's something I've always felt. And I think we on the left, like I've watched with, I've gone back every cycle to Wisconsin. And I have seen, I'm putting this simply, but we're a little too cool for school to care about local and state politics. You know, we'll get upset about the big national things. I think this is changing a lot. And I think the work you're doing and the work that a lot of what I see in Wisconsin is a lot more awareness that we need to work the political levers that we have. You can't culture won't do it alone. So that's something I feel I've always felt very strongly about. I'm always telling people to listen. I'm not just some, you know, guy who got lucky in Hollywood and you should care about Wisconsin because that's where I'm from. It is an ideological swing state. It's why it was targeted by Rove and the Koch brothers. It resonates nationally. And people really, I do now, I really think they understand that about Wisconsin. And I am so inspired by the, I think the work Ben Wickler's done has been incredible. I think if we had a Ben Wickler in New York and in California, where there is absolutely no structure, we would not have lost a house. And going back there every cycle and seeing people, it's just excruciating, these close races.
Oh, yeah.
And I so am so inspired by the tenacity of the activists in Wisconsin.
And I've only been back for a couple cycles, and it's never ending. And so, especially now when the spring elections feel even more important than the election we just finished 6 months ago, which
Sisyphus.
I definitely want to talk more because it's not like you came post-Trump. Like, you were here during Act 10. Like, you've been caring about Wisconsin politics despite having your career and everything like that. So we're going to talk about that more when we come back, along with maybe any predictions you have for tomorrow, because, you know, we're all in the prediction game after 2016.
It's a great idea.
Totally. Yeah. All right. Our guest is Bradley Whitford. He is going to continue to be with us after the break. Stay with us. This is As Goes Wisconsin.
Family has one. The Smother.
Holy why!
Hi, Erica.
This is my daughter. I baked her in my tummy.
The Goldbergs every weeknight.
Weeknights at 5 and 5:30 on My24.
With a house full of women, it's every man for himself.
What is it about hanging bras in the bathroom like Christmas ornaments? If I don't hang my underwear in the bathroom, that would be terrifying.
Tim Allen is the last man standing.
Weeknights at 6 and 6:30 on My24.
The Devil's Advocates.
Today, I made a mental note. It was 1:09 Central Time when I found out Ron Johnson was a conspirator in a coup, a traitor to the Constitution. And Ron's been something of an apologist. You know, they seem real friendly. Well, maybe to you, Ron, because you were on the inside of the coup. And I've never made that accusation prior to today. So let's play it for the people.
This staffer stated that Senator Johnson wished to hand-deliver the fake electors' votes from Michigan and Wisconsin.
Follow The Devil's Advocates on Facebook and Twitter.
What is dedication?
I think a parent's job is to protect our children, but also prepare them for the world so they become good, kind human beings.
That's dedication. Find out more at fatherhood.gov.
You are listening to your local Civic Media radio station on air. Thank you. Did you know we are always streaming on TuneIn and the Civic Media app too? And if you miss a show or game, find it wherever you get your podcasts or on our website, civicmedia.us.
Here's your updated forecast on the Shaw. Chance for scattered showers this afternoon. Otherwise, cloudy skies expected. Highs around 56. Westerly winds 5 to 10 miles an hour. Scattered rain showers again tonight. Lows dip down to about 39. Overcast skies. Cloudy skies expected again tomorrow. Scattered thunderstorms likely. Daytime highs approaching 49. For Civic Media, I'm meteorologist Derek Height. Currently, it's 55 degrees.
The Shaw 101 FM, your fix for progressive talk. From Muskego to Pewaukee, always streaming at waukradio.com.
Hi, I'm Bradley Whitford from The West Wing, a show featuring an idealized Washington, D.C. that inspired an entire generation of future politicians to try and make a difference by just doing the right thing.
And I'm Julia Louis-Dreyfus from Veep, a show that did not do any of that.
The road to saving democracy runs directly through my home state of Wisconsin.
Welcome back to As Goes Wisconsin. We are joined by actor, activist, Emmy Award winner, Wisconsin native entertainer, Bradley Whitford. And that was a video I actually found on TikTok this morning of that you made with Julia Louis-Dreyfus.
Julia's incredible. I love her. I've known her a little bit, but she is very aware. She really focuses on down ballot races, which is, I think, a very effective. Look, I am fully aware. The first question, I know that the last thing anybody needs is somebody, you know, with a horseshoe hanging out of their ass in Hollywood. The last thing any local candidate needs is some, you know, predictable Hollywood lefty, you know, telling people what to think. But what you can do is use all this silly attention that we get and, you know, make people know about Josh Call and make people understand what the stakes are. So she's very smart about that.
She is very smart about that. But as are you, because I know it was, I didn't get to see it, but I feel like that was a huge draw last fall when you guys did the mashup of The West Wing and Veep, and the David Mandel wrote it as far as doing that mashup and that fundraiser. And I do think there's something interesting with exactly what you said. It's not so much having celebrities tell you what to think, but using a platform to at least know that, tell you that it's even happening.
Right. And to everybody who says, oh, what are you celebrities? You know, by the way, I'm proud of the activist progressive community in Hollywood. Nobody, we're not out there saying, give us a tax break. We are fighting for voting rights. We're fighting for rational gun laws, as opposed to the very powerful moneyed interests that are, it's part of what I was saying before. I think part of the reason we're in the place we are in is the right is basically pursuing a kind of selfish libertarian business agenda fueled by culture wars, right? And in order to do that, it's not an extracurricular. They're in there all day, every day, because it's business. And we on the left, I think, you know, again, need to really apply pressure on all levels of the political system in order to get to the place where the majority of this country actually wants to be on guns, on the climate, mm-hmm. On rights. It's actually on women's rights. It's actually not even close.
And yet, here we are.
And yet, the election is close.
The election is close.
And okay, so I guess, here, you want to hear my prediction?
Sure.
If all of your listeners don't get everyone in their family and five of their friends to vote, we're going to lose.
I think that's a good pressure. That's a good pressure to put on everybody. But yes. The onus is on you.
Yes.
There's absolutely, go get your friends. I actually told a story. I had a family member who, despite the fact that I have a radio show and countless social media posts about the vote, about the election, and have been posting about it and talking about it for 2 months, when asked this weekend, I said, are you going to vote on Tuesday? This family member said, on what? And you never know who of your family and friends just is too preoccupied with other things. And honestly, it's, you know, I don't blame them as far as having other priorities, because some of this can be exhausting. And those of us who are crazy enough to continue to be so consumed with it, I think we're needed too, but it's not realistic to have everyone. And so,
listen,
go ahead.
We all have, you know, ADH. Did the Bucks win? You know, and like digital dementia. Like we're all scattered, really, and people, you know, people are busy. So you have to remind them. The thing of like, it's excruciating in Wisconsin, but there's actually a lot of power because it's so calcified and so close. If you can change your uncle's mind, you can save democracy.
And that, I mean, and there is power in that as far as being like, you know, an otherwise flyover state. And I think it's funny to see my friends who are on the coast start to understand that. I think is like the political IQ of the average citizen has gone way up over the last 7 years. If Trump's done anything good for this country, I would say it's the increased political engagement of so many more people who were checked out prior to that. Well, and so I feel like now people, for the first time, Wisconsin was like, oh, Packers, I don't know, sports, cheese, brats. And now I think there's an actual understanding, especially right now with this election, that we are a political centerpiece of what happens in the country.
And there's, you know, one of the things I'm most proud of in Wisconsin is, you know, the entire New Deal came out of the Wisconsin idea. All of the successful programs that we love were basically workshopped in Wisconsin. They had unemployment insurance in, I don't know, 1915. And that's why it's been a target of the Koch brothers and Karl Rove. Karl Rove, who at this point looks like Abby Hoffman. I mean, who could predict how crazy these people would be? It's unbelievable.
It is. And yet we persevere. So
can you imagine if on the West Wing, I always say the fakest thing about West Wing was we had rational Republicans. Can you imagine if we did put a Republican like Trump up there, we would have be seen as, you know, being totally unrealistic.
Anyways, this go vote. Bradley Whitford, thank you so much
Stop
for spending
listening.
Time with us.
Go vote.
All right. Thank you so much. We'll keep you posted on what happens.
Please let me know. Let me know how it turns out. I love you, Wisconsin. Goodbye.
Goodbye. Stay tuned. This is As Goes Wisconsin.
I go to where there ain't no stopping no lights, but I got no desire for the 5-star resort. Got a cousin with a cabin way up north. When it's cold in the winter, I drink beer and treat. When the snow unthaws, you can...
The Shaw 101 FM, Brookfield's choice for news talk radio. Streaming 24/7 at waukradio.com.
CBS News Brief. Former President Donald Trump is on his way to New York for his arraignment in connection with hush money paid during his 2016 campaign. New York's Police Commissioner Keyshawn Sewell.
I won't go into how many numbers of police officers will be on the street, but we will have enough to facilitate mobile units if we need to respond to anything. But this is a collaborative effort with our partners in the Secret Service.
There is no specific threat. In Nashville, students and others are marching on the state capitol after a school shooting that left 3 children and 3 adults dead. Bobby Sloan is with Students Demand Action.
People are trying to distract from the larger issue, which is also that this doesn't just happen in schools. Gun violence is the leading cause of death in American youth, and that is not just in schools, that is anywhere.
And more severe weather affecting the country, New York Odyssey meteorologist Craig Allen.
We're going to have another tornado outbreak, likely, up and down the Mississippi River Valley.
CBS News Brief, I'm Cammie McCormick.
The Shaw 101 FM, WAUK 540 AM, Waukesha's only news talk station.
For Civic Media News, I'm Terry Bell. Here's what you need to know. The National Weather Service says at least 9 tornadoes touched down in southern Wisconsin during Friday's storms. One tornado that traveled between Judah and Albany carved a path about 10 miles long and 350 yards wide. The National Weather Service confirms 8 other tornadoes from Monroe to Jefferson. A crew is in Iowa County today. Former President Donald Trump may be arraigned tomorrow, the same day Wisconsin voters choose their next state Supreme Court justice. Political observers say it may boost Trump supporters to turn out for Dan Kelly.
every indication is this race is tightening at the end. I don't think both sides would be loading up and unloading their cannons if they didn't think that they had a chance.
Republican strategist Bill McCaution was on Upfront yesterday. In sports, the Bucks beat Philadelphia last night. The Brewers host the Mets today. I'm Terry Bell, and this is Civic Media News.
Hey everybody, how we doing? I'm Charlie Behrens, inviting you to join me Saturdays and or Sundays at noon. It's a horse apiece, whatever you decide. We're doing the Cripes Cast, where we talk to people for and or from the Midwest, and it's more fun than a six-pack of Jolly Good. Okay, the pride of Random Lake, that Jolly Good is. Anyway, it's on your Civic Media station and the Civic Media app. And do me a favor, yeah, tell your folks I says hi. Okay, real good.
Accidents can be life-changing, no matter how careful you are. But with Gingras Thompson and Walks, you're not alone. For decades, they've been fighting for the rights of people just like you. They'll let you focus on your recovery while they handle the legal complexities. If you or a loved one has been hurt or killed due to someone else's negligence, contact them now. You may deserve compensation.
All in Gingras Thompson and Walks, GTWLawyers.com.
On Tuesday, April 4th, we have a chance to elect people who will do the right thing for Wisconsin and for Waukesha. We need experienced leaders we can trust. Vote for Janet Protasiewicz for Supreme Court, Fred Stram for Waukesha County Circuit Court, and Diane Voigt for Waukesha School Board. Janet, Fred, Diane, because we can trust them. Vote on April 4th. Your vote and your voice matter.
Paid for by Blue Sky Waukesha.
Dad, I picked up your pills, made your lunch, and your laundry is done.
When you care for a loved one, you take care of everything. But are you taking care of yourself? Find free care guides at aarp.org/caregiving. Brought to you by AARP and the Ad Council.
You're a rich girl, and you're gone too far, because you know it don't matter anyway. You can rely on the old man's money. You can rely on the old man's money. It's a bitch, girl.
Well, welcome back to As Goes Wisconsin. I am Kristen Bry. She is Jane Madnair. And now we can take a breath.
Yes. Yes. It's been a busy show.
It's been a very busy show.
What a lovely man.
What a love. Both all of our guests. Yeah, all of our guests today have been great. But yeah, Bradley was very energetic.
Yep.
I feel like he could have just led the interview.
I think he's done a couple of
times, yeah. But actually Fancy Brian texted me. His first interview on the radio was with Bradley.
Oh, wow.
I guess years back. And so obviously Bradley Whitford, generous with his time when it comes to politics and activism, very outspoken.
Surprised me, though, because I did not realize that he was here when Act 10 was all happening and that he was involved with it way back then.
And that's, you know, it went, these go by so fast. And so I wanted to ask, because I think, as we've said before, there was kind of this like before and after of 2016. And clearly he's someone who has been engaged way before that. And also, I think it's interesting, and maybe I'll send him a follow-up email, because I am curious of, you know, for people who, when they move and they get careers, and that not just acting, business, whatever.
Can be anything, yeah.
And what is it about your home state that keeps you involved, even if you have no plans to live there again? And had Wisconsin not had such a turn on a dime with the Scott Walker years of, you know, from being still a purple state that had more progressive leanings, certainly progressive history, to what, like you said, the influx of money from Koch brothers and then the domino effect that led from that to the world we live in now in Wisconsin. And what was it, had that not been the case here, would he have stayed as involved and interested in Wisconsin politics? Or is it because Wisconsin is a fascinating place when it comes to politics that's always kept him having an eye on his
home
state?
Keep an eye on things,
yeah. But super interesting, as he said, if you don't get your friends and your family to vote tomorrow, we're going to lose. And so take that, all of that pressure, and wear it and feel it and send those text messages and those reminders and help people get them to the ballot, to the polling place tomorrow to fill out their ballot.
Yes.
And so did you end up voting on Friday?
I did not. So, I'm going to go tomorrow.
So we're both going tomorrow. Yep. Yep. After the show.
Yep. And I'm fine with that. I like to look in at my little poll workers and the volunteers and see how they're doing and always just check their pulse to see, you know,
see what number you are at your polling station.
See what number I am and how that compared to the last time. And just as kind of a little indicator, the weather again is probably not going to be ideal, especially if you have to vote after what, like 4 o'clock.
Yeah.
So there might be some rain. We can get wet. On the way to the polling places, we're not going to melt.
We're not going to melt.
We're not going to melt.
But also, you know, I think like I can walk to my polling place. It's 2 blocks away. And
that's
so
nice.
So that's really nice as far as I think for some people when, you know, when they make, this is why we want plenty of polling places, right? Because
yes.
In times when weather is hard, it is an unfair burden to make some people have to drive way further instead of just making it as easy as possible to vote. Vote safely, vote securely,
yep.
But still make it easy for people to exercise their right to vote. And so really looking forward to the anxiety of that comes with Election Day. And then we get a break. We get a break until
from
elections for the rest of the year. We get time off. I'm sure there'll be plenty to talk about.
Oh, yes.
Between the budgets, obviously the presidential election is just around the corner and there'll be plenty to talk about there. But at least from political ads and the anxiety that is Wisconsin elections, we will get a little bit of a break. But here's a reminder that if you liked what you heard on the primary coverage from Civic Media back in February during the primary, we're doing it again tomorrow night.
Yes.
Jane and I will be doing a special edition of As Goes Wisconsin during primetime, 7 to 8, to take home the last hour of the polls being open. And so we're going to have Patrick Marley join us.
Yes, from the...
longtime Milwaukee Journal Sentinel reporter, now works for the Washington Post, being a Midwest political reporter. I haven't talked to him since he's taken that role on, which I think has been about a year now that he's been over there.
Yeah, that seems right.
And so excited to talk to him about what he's been hearing and how I just think it's interesting for the people who are constantly talking. It's the same reason why Jeff Charlotte, what was really interesting of just being on the ground, having conversations and versus talking about the conversations you're hearing other people have.
Yeah. Which is valuable. I mean, but that's. That is valuable.
Oh, yeah.
Those one-on-one interactions. That's really the only way how you find out anything, right?
Exactly. So be sure to tune in for tomorrow. Civic Media is going to have coverage all night long with an extra hour of Devil's Advocates going until 7 p.m. Then Jane and I will take over at 7. And then Terry Bell and the crew and all of our correspondents across the state will be following local elections.
Yeah. School board races,
mayor's elections. I know there's a super tight mayor election in Green Bay, Racine, school boards. Yeah. So there will be a lot to be unfolded tomorrow night on top, you know, in addition to the very, very big Wisconsin Supreme Court race. But I've been wanting to talk about this. Did you watch the Gwyneth Paltrow trial at all last week?
I didn't. I followed it very lightly in some of the publications that I follow.
Same. And I just, because I didn't, some of this pop culture stuff, like it just doesn't really interest me. But now that it's over, it's almost like the real life White Lotus playing out in front of us of just like the, or Succession or any of these shows of the like uber rich people who just live like celebrities. They're just like us, except no, they're not.
No, they're not.
No, they're not at all. And not even just celebrities, but just like the very, very wealthy. I was listening to an interview of Kieran Culkin, who's on Succession, who plays Ronan. And I love him. He's such a good actor. But he was, and it was like, what, I think the question was, what have you learned about billionaires in doing this show? And he's like, oh, they don't wear coats because they're never outside. And he goes, there's been a couple of times I've picked out a coat for Ronan to wear in scenes, but we're either in a car or we step outside for like a couple feet to get onto the plane or walk into the, so it just feels cumbersome to have a coat.
Sure.
And you don't need one. And I was like, oh my, I would have never thought that.
That's really interesting. And it makes complete sense.
It's a very different reason than the college Wisconsin girls who don't wear coats because it ruins their outfits and just are going to drink enough that they're not going to feel it anyway. So it's a little different. But anyways, so I followed more of this Gwyneth Paltrow trial, and it's just, and I feel like were people obsessed with it? Because people were obsessed with it as far as the internet being very excited about this. And it's like, is it the same obsession why they keep making these like billionaire rich people problem shows? That there's just something about celebrity and money that no matter what, we are just captured by, even when it's trivial. And like part of it is almost so we can look down on them in their stupid little trivial problems, even though we give them so much attention. It's such a weird conundrum of why you simultaneously, as like the general masses, watch this with bated breath and are like fascinated by it, but also it's not because they have any, I don't know,
redeeming qualities.
Well, it's redeeming qualities.
I was going to say, you just described the Kardashians.
Yeah, but it's like, because like Gwyneth Paltrow has for a while now felt like someone who is, to put it lightly, out of touch.
Well, her Goop website is insane.
The Goop website, the pseudoscience of like health science and wellness and stuff. And she was on some interview recently about how into like IVs she is, of like different IV drips, that I then saw a medical professional respond to being like, please don't do this. This is not a real thing. Please do not think you need to go out and buy and pay for IV drips to be healthy. Like, yeah,
you don't.
And so, but she won. So basically what I understand this trial to be is that there was a very wealthy optometrist who was like in his 70s. And this was like 7 years ago. This was a long time ago.
Right.
Who he was suing her because his story was that she crashed into him
skiing.
And her countersuit was, no, you crashed into me. So he was suing her for, at first it was going to be like $3 million, and then it got knocked down to $300,000. And she countersued him for $1 and lawyer fees.
Right.
And she won. So this happened in 2016, and the trial was just now. And the jury found the man 100% at fault. And it was just, but like the trial itself was full of these wacky moments, which included Gwyneth Paltrow being asked, like, you know, what she lost. And she goes, well, I lost half a day of skiing.
That got a lot of mockery on Twitter.
There was also like a line of questioning around her being friends with Taylor Swift. And is that why she was like, because Taylor Swift also had like a countersuit at one point for like a symbolic $1. And so if there was like a friendship there, which again, I don't know why. What that has to do with the trial. But then at one point, they were also asking about how tall Gwyneth Paltrow was. And this was the interaction. The plaintiff's lawyer, so his lawyer, may I ask how tall you are? I'm just under 5'10". I'm so jealous. I think I'm shrinking, though. That's Paltrow. I have to wear 4-inch heels just to make it to 5'5". And then Paltrow said, well, they're very nice. Like, what's happening?
But that's on the lawyer.
That is on the lawyer.
You know, I mean, that's just goofy. What are you doing?
But this, I do have to say, the way that it ended is fabulous. As far as she won the case.
So she gets her dollar, and he has to cover her court fees.
And her lawyer fees. And she, as they won, and I don't think she made a huge fuss about it, but as she walked out of the courtroom, she leaned over to Dr. Sanderson, who was the optometrist, and she whispered 4 words into his ear, and they were, I wish you well.
That's nice.
It is nice. It is nice. And I think he said thank you. And they moved on. Because the whole thing about this was that it was he was just trying to grift her.
Right.
And that he actually crashed into her, that he wasn't actually a very good skier. And then he didn't even know who she was at first until someone after the crash
pointed out
that's Gwyneth Paltrow. And then he saw dollar signs. And so it seems like justice was served, but it still is like this obsession with how celebrities and rich people aren't actually like us at all. And why we are so captured by them is timeless, apparently, because there is a lot of show, both fictional and real life, of us wanting to witness them existing.
And now I know it's because they don't wear coats.
Isn't that fascinating?
It is. That it explains so much, though. It really does.
Unless it's a fashion statement. They certainly don't have a Land's End sleeping bag coat like I do.
No,
really, really like Nanook of the North. All right, we got one more segment. Stay with us. This is As Goes Wisconsin.
On Tuesday, April 4th, we have a chance to elect people who will do the right thing for Wisconsin and for Waukesha. We need experienced leaders we can trust. Vote for Janet Protasewicz for Supreme Court, Fred Stram for Waukesha County Circuit Court, and Diane Voigt for Waukesha School Board. Janet, Fred, Diane, because we can trust them. Vote on April 4th. Your vote and your voice matter.
Paid for by Blue Sky Waukesha.
Civic Media promised you something big to celebrate our new and still growing network of radio stations. When we announced the one-day $1 million advertising giveaway for Wisconsin businesses, you responded.
Just wanted to echo your sentiments about the advertising. That's really a cool deal.
We got a text really about remarkable. IVs.
$1 million of free
advertising. And we'll do a little Brewers update with the score.
If you missed this chance to work with our team, go to civicmedia.us and click on the sponsorship tab. One of our local sales pros will get right back to you. Civicmedia.us and sponsorship.
It's 4 a.m. and you're sucking baby snot through a tube because she's congested. If you love her that much, love her enough to make sure she's buckled in the right car seat. Find out more at nhtsa.gov/the right seat. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
Weather brought to you by Wisconsin Cheese and Popcorn Shop at civicmedia.us/shop.
Home of buttery popcorn treats that make your mouth water.
Caramel, cookies and cream, strawberry shortcake and more. civicmedia.us/shop.
Part of the proceeds benefit Wisconsin athletic programs.
Here's your updated forecast on the Shaw. Scattered rain showers likely this afternoon, otherwise overcast. Highs level off around 56, winds out of the west 5 to 10 miles an hour. Scattered rain showers likely tonight. Lows dip down to about 39. Cloudy skies expected. Overcast skies again tomorrow. Scattered thunderstorms likely. High temperatures reach up to 49. For Civic Media, I'm meteorologist Derek Height. Currently, it's 55 degrees.
The Shaw 101 FM, your fix for progressive talk. From Big Bend to Menominee Falls. Always streaming at waukradio.com.
Welcome back to As Goes Wisconsin. I am Kristen Bry. She is Jane Matinair, and we are rounding out our election eve show and talking. We had some fun in the No Sour Haha Fun Time Hour, obviously with Bradley Whitford, but then opining over what it is with our obsession with celebrities and in regards to the Gwyneth Paltrow trial that came to an end last week. And you said someone had some insight on the IV thing.
Because Gwyneth Paltrow is a big believer in getting various drips in IVs, apparently. Yeah. So Kristen from Iguanago says H2O in Brookfield for IVs. Don't knock it till you try it.
Well, and I have heard, like, I did it once in Vegas.
You did?
As a hangover cure.
Oh.
Because I have heard that as far as, because if you think about it, when you're hungover, you are dehydrated. And they upcharge you with different vitamins and stuff like that. So I think it's, I certainly think it makes you feel better. I would be interested, Kristen from Iguanago. Did she spell it with an I or an E?
Let me look. Because I know I'm really concerned about this.
Of course.
She spelled it the correct way. Yay. With an I.
So Kristen from Iguanago, I think, is there a difference between you definitely feel better after you do it versus there actually being health benefits? And because, you know, like I feel great after a steam room, but I think sometimes there is, especially, you know, there's different people says that kind of heat or whatever, like
isn't
too much time.
You?
Yeah. Like things that feel good versus the health benefits from them, I think are different. And so unless the person I saw trying to debunk the Gwyneth Paltrow pushing this as far as, you know, how good this is for you. Because, you know, for a little while, like juice cleanses were really good for you. But then there's a bunch of people who are like, no, your body not naturally knows how to like detox your body. That's why you have a liver and kidneys. And you don't need to just drink juice to give your body a break. Like your body can figure it
out.
Your
body's been working.
Yes. And so we also had a comment on the live stream that celebrities kind of fill the role that Greek and Roman gods did. Their lives are a little more morality plays for the common folk, which is that's interesting for us to comment and have opinions on and just totally forget that they're human beings. Yeah.
Brewers updates.
Oh, yeah.
Brewers home opener is underway at AmFam Field in Milwaukee, and it's a very exciting third inning zip zip.
And clipping along because of the new rules.
See, now I'm intrigued because you are the first person that I've heard from who said that they could actually feel a difference in speeding things up a little bit.
Oh, have you talked to other people who said they felt like it was the same?
Yeah.
Oh. Well, again, I think I was under a unique situation of watching the game on Saturday.
Because you were freezing today?
Because I was freezing. And I was trying to be a good sport because I would like to think that, you know, I'm up for anything. But it was one of those moments that there was enough time that I was like, in my mind, I didn't say it out loud, but I'm saying it out loud now. I was like, why did I say yes to this? This is not that much fun.
I am not having fun.
I'm not having fun. It was like, you know how there's things, it's like, to me, it's like skiing because I'm not a good skier. I remember, this was a couple years ago, Dr. Mike and his husband live in Colorado. And so we had made the plan that we would go to drive from Denver to Breckenridge on a Saturday.
Oh boy.
To go skiing. And the only person, like, Mike's a decent skier. Mike's husband's a good skier. Mike is getting better. And I had not skied. And so somehow we thought this was a good idea.
Oh gosh, on a Saturday too.
So we leave at 7 a.m. and still get stuck in bumper to bumper traffic. So it takes us 3 hours to get there.
Ugh.
So by the time we actually get there, we can't park near the mountain. So we have to park somewhere in Breckenridge and then take a shuttle to the mountain, schlepping all of our stuff.
Just so much fun.
It was really cold that day. Because it was my first time skiing, obviously fall a couple times. And that frustrating feeling, especially for people who feel like they're somewhat athletic, when you are stuck like a turtle on your back and you're like, I don't even know how to get up from this position.
No, right.
And your friends are trying to help you, but you're so embarrassed and you're like sweating, but
yes,
cold at the same time. You're like, yeah, no, I don't want your help. I don't want this to stop.
Yep.
And
I want to be off the mountain now.
And so then eventually I kind of got the hang of it and went down a couple times, but it was also this was 2021. So all the rules on the mountain, like you couldn't even be inside. Like
once you got
your food, you had to go eat it outside. And if you were like, you had to have a mask all the time. And it was one of those things. I was like, are we having fun? Why are we doing this? Like, this is supposed to be fun, and nothing about this is fun. And yet we've convinced ourselves to spend this much money and this much effort in the name of having a good day. And I'm going to say it right now, not a good day.
So I assume you have not gone skiing again.
I've not, but I do want to get better at skiing. So it is more fun, but it was like going to the beach on a day where it's windy and everyone keeps trying to convince, like, aren't we having fun with sand everywhere and it's cold and the water's too cold to actually get in. But like, and it was hell trying to park and we had to pay and then schlep everything, especially then you have kids and you're like, I have to get sand off the kids.
My one recommendation for you would be don't learn how to ski in Colorado.
No, I know. I need to go somewhere in Wisconsin where it's hills instead of mountains.
You need something a little less death defying when you're starting.
A little less steep.
A little less steep. Yeah.
All right. Well, that will do it for us today. But I'm sure, actually, I think William Walter is filling in because Luke and Brian, I think, are at opening day today.
Ooh.
And so you have a guest host for Dueling Tangents, but Chad Holmes is there. And tomorrow, it's going to be a lot of election coverage. I don't know if anything's going to break between tonight and tomorrow as far as big stories, but clearly we'll certainly be talking about it.
Absolutely.
And mark your calendars for tomorrow night, because Civic Media is going to have special coverage, just like we did for the primary and for the midterm elections last fall. Special Devil's Advocates go until 7. Jane and I will be on from 7 to 8.
Exactly.
And then we will have coverage from all of our correspondents across the state as results roll in tomorrow night. So looking forward to that. But as for today, thank you for listening and calling and texting. Come back tomorrow at 11 a.m. when we'll do this all again. This has been As Goes Wisconsin.